Hey all, this is Carmen with DrNurse.com, and tonight I wanted to talk to you guys about using critical thinking to answer all your nursing questions correctly. Now, we all know that nursing questions are very different than any other test questions that you've had to answer in school so far. And a lot of students and people have contacted me, emailed me, contacted me through Facebook, and asked how to study for different subjects, like how do I study for farm versus med surg. And there's just not like a one size fits all approach to studying, because there's so much difference in nursing programs. Some nursing programs, they're just going to lecture to you. Some nursing programs are going to do an entire flipped classroom method. So as far as an approach to studying, there's tips and tricks that I can give you, but there is kind of a one-size-fits-all or a step-by-step process for answering any nursing question. And I want to talk to you about these four simple steps. Now, what I'm going to discuss in this video is kind of adapted from what's called the Kaplan Decision Tree. And it's a great tool that Kaplan test prep created to help you work through NCLEX style problems. So I want to talk about kind of my version of the decision tree tonight. So the first step when you're looking at a nursing question and you're like, I just don't know, I've got it narrowed down between A and C and I'm just not sure. Step one, you want to look at the question stem and reword that question. If you don't understand what that question is asking and you're not able to put it into your own words, you might as well just be going eeny, meeny, miny, mo, because you're not going to arrive at the correct answer if you can't figure out what the question is asking. So put the question stem into your own words. So like if it's a priority action question, then say to yourself, okay, this question is asking what is the most important thing to do in this situation, like for a patient who has new onset ST elevation. Okay, ask yourself, what is the one thing that I could do before turning around and leaving this patient's bedside? If there were only one thing that I could choose to do, what will it be? And that's kind of how you can reword a priority action question or a priority intervention question and put it into your own words. Number two, you want to look at your answer choices, or as we nurse educators call them, the distractors. And they're called distractors for a reason. There are typically three incorrect answer choices and one correct one. We put those other three in there to distract you from the correct answer, all right? But how do you arrive at that correct answer? Well, step two, you're gonna label every single answer choice as either an assessment or an intervention. Is the nurse listening to breath sounds or taking a temperature? Well, that's an assessment. Is the nurse raising up the head of the bed or giving a medication or calling the provider even? Those are all interventions. The nurse is doing something. The nurse is taking action to change the patient's situation or change the patient's status, all right? So label your answer choices assessments or interventions. The reason for this, as you know, the nursing process, there are several steps in the nursing process. Assessment is the first step in the nursing process. So once you have your answer choices labeled as assessments or interventions, if you have a mix of both, say you have two assessments, two interventions, you want to look at those assessment answer choices first, okay? Assessment is the first step in the nursing process. Assessments are the first things you want to try to eliminate as being the correct answer choice when you're trying to answer a nursing question. So look at those assessment answer choices very closely and say to yourself, all right, is there enough assessment information in this question stem that I can go ahead and act on the information to do something to change the patient's status? or do I need further assessment? Okay, if you answer no, I don't need any further assessment, then you can probably eliminate those assessment answer choices. Okay, like if you have, let's say an unstable patient. You have an unstable patient that has, you know, a really high heart rate and a really low blood pressure and their mental status is declining, all right? We have enough information in that picture that we know that this patient is unstable. There is something surely that we can do without completing further assessments, like, you know, reevaluating the blood pressure to validate that the number is correct. Well, we don't really need to do that if the patient's heart rate is also high and the patient's mental status has declined, okay? Something is going on with the patient. We have enough information there to conclude that the patient is unstable, those vital signs are correct, because there's not just one vital sign that's out of range. There are two or three or four things that all fit together to form a clinical picture of instability. All right, so the next step. Once you have everything labeled assessment or interventions, you've possibly been able to maybe eliminate a couple of answer choices, or maybe you haven't, that's fine. Still move on to step three, where you label every answer choice that's left, the ones that you haven't eliminated yet, label them as either physiologic or psychosocial, okay? You know that Maslow's hierarchy of needs puts physiologic needs, which are basic vital signs and safety, those types needs are at the top of the pyramid. Down at the bottom are things like emotional well-being, mental health, you know, those are important, but according to Maslow's, the physiologic needs are more important. And just a little tip that NCLEX considers pain a psychosocial need. So by and large, for the most part, pain is not going to be a priority if you have other physiologic answer choices to choose from. And then finally, if you still have some answer choices left and you're still like, oh, I just don't know, you're going to use the good old ABCs, all right? Airway, breathing, circulation. What are some things that the nurse does to address the airway? We raise the head of the bed. We make sure that a patient with dysphagia swallows their food properly. We turn patients to the side if they are vomiting. Anything that you do to prevent aspiration, to open up the airway, like inserting an oral airway before you bag someone. Those types of interventions are going to be the priority interventions, okay? So open up the airway, patient positioning, those type things. Breathing, what do we do that addresses breathing? Well, we give oxygen. We address a low oxygen saturation. We correct ventilation, meaning a very high CO2 level. Okay, all those measures are considered addressing breathing. Now, if a patient's airway is blocked, meaning a piece of food has gone down the wrong way, then bagging the patient or giving them oxygen or putting them on the vent, it's not going to do any good, okay? So you've got to make sure that airway is open and clear. Then you want to address breathing. Then once we have established an airway and established good oxygenation and ventilation, we will address circulation. So how do we address circulation? Blood pressure, heart rate, pulse quality, maintaining normal volume, okay? So anything that addresses fluid volume overload, fluid volume deficit, blood pressure, hanging blood, those are all circulation issues, all right? So, you know, I like to say, I don't care what the patient's blood pressure is if they're choking, all right? That's just putting airway before breathing and before circulation, okay? So when in doubt, just refer back to your ABCs. I hope y'all have found these tips helpful. Always kind of revert back to these four steps if you're ever hung up on a particular nursing question. I wrote a complete blog post on this subject today. It is up on the site, thedoctornurse.com, under blog. Also, if you look under the See What's New section, I have a real quick reference guide with these four steps identified on the reference guide. You can download it to PDF and print it out and take it with you. Take it with you to clinical, take it with you to class. Use it to answer studies for case studies and stuff like that. That'll get you in the habit of thinking this way. And I just want to thank you guys so much for watching. Go ahead and go to thedoctornurse.com. Subscribe to the mailing list so you won't miss out on any updates or any new resources or videos that I've posted on The Doctor Nurse. And again, thank you so much for watching and have a wonderful night.